What is a passkey? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Now, by now, I'm sure you know the frustration of creating and using and managing and forgetting passwords. But what if there was a way that once you signed into your device, all of the subsequent sign-ins happened securely and automatically without your needing to remember much of anything? In the coming years, you are going to be hearing more and more about something called passkeys. Not passwords, not passphrases, passkeys. In fact, you might already be using them without even realizing it. Let's differentiate between those three authentication methods first. As the name implied, passwords are an authentication method where, in addition to your user ID, you prove who you are by entering a word, a collection of characters that you previously defined as the password, to your account. The word password is, of course, a very bad password because it's short and simple and easy to guess. But something like JY9ZDQBNSWQMUYCIC2XW, well, you can guess that's pretty good because it's very long, it's random, and it's essentially unguessable. Passphrases are passwords made up of multiple words. I love Lucy is a bad passphrase because it's a famous phrase all on its own. Until it was used as a popular example of a passphrase, correct horse battery staple was a good passphrase because it's lengthy and the words are unrelated. Jon Snow, you know nothing, is a decent passphrase because it's an erroneous mix-up of an easy-to-remember phrase. Passkeys are something else entirely. They use what's called public key cryptography. They might be the safest and the easiest to use, but they're also the most difficult to explain, so please bear with me on that. Now, I do want to point out, this is a high-level conceptual overview. It's not meant to be accurate at the bits and bytes detailed level. Actual passkey implementations are honestly difficult to get. I believe the concepts here are accurate enough to understand the basics of how the technology works. If I later discover inaccuracies, of course, I'll update the article, which in fact, this video is a reflection of. Public key cryptography is the workhorse of most online encryption. It's what's used, for example, to secure HTTPS connections, the SSL/TLS connections configured in your email program, and much, much more. The concept is very simple. Two large numbers, really large numbers, A and B, are created using a special mathematical formula. Among many other things, they have the following relationships to one another. You cannot calculate one from the other, and anything you encrypt using one can only be decrypted using the other. That last point is important. If you encrypt some data using the number A as the encryption key, then only B can be used to decrypt it. Similarly, anything encrypted using B as the encryption key can only be decrypted by A. A cannot decrypt A, and B cannot decrypt B. Only B can decrypt something encrypted using A, and only A can be used to decrypt something using B. I think of it as two locks on the same box. If you lock the box using key A, it can only be opened with key B. If you lock the box using key B, it can only be opened by using key A. Yeah, it sounds magical. It is. It's digital and mathematical magic as far as I'm concerned. It's beautiful magic if you're into that kind of thing, but it's magic nonetheless. Now, I did mention that this is typically called public key cryptography. Here's why. Public key encryption or authentication refers to the use of both keys in these magical key pairs. One of them is referred to as the public key. The other is the secret or private key. Now, if I keep A secret and make B public, then two interesting things are really possible. Anyone can encrypt something using that public key B that only I can decrypt using my private key A. If I encrypt something using my secret key A, anyone can confirm that only I could have encrypted it if they are able to decrypt it using the public key B. Indeed, I've got a publicly available public key that anyone can use to encrypt a message to me. Given that only I have the corresponding private key, only I can decrypt it. Public key encryption can enable authentication that doesn't use passwords. This is actually something that's been used on Linux systems for decades. You create a key pair, public and a private key. You keep your private key in a safe place, and you don't share it with anyone. It's private. You give the public key to the owner of the server you want to connect to. Now you try to sign into the server. The server says, in effect, I'm thinking of a number. I'll encrypt this number using your public key and give you the encrypted result. Now, tell me what number I'm thinking of. Since you are in possession of the corresponding private key, which you kept safe and secure, the tool you're using to sign in can decrypt the data the server sent you. It can then respond to the server, no problem, here's the number, and provide whatever that number is. Because you had the matching private key, only you could have decrypted the information, and only you could have responded with the correct number. You must be you. And it all happened behind the scenes without your doing a thing. I've been using this type of authentication to connect to my Linux servers for, gosh, probably 2 decades by now. All right, passkeys. Passkeys are public-private key pairs that are automatically generated for you. The public key is kept on the service that supports passkeys, like Google as one example, and the private key is stored securely on your computer. When you sign in, the service responds with a challenge that is encrypted using your public key. Because your computer has your private key, it can correctly decrypt that challenge, proving that you are who you say you are. Access granted. And all of that is completely transparent to you, other than perhaps needing to unlock your computer's securely stored repository of private keys. Now, we'll talk about that in a second. Passkeys are unique to each device. Note that in its basic form, a passkey key pair is different for each machine you use. So, for example, I might have a key pair for my Google account accessed from my desktop, a key pair for my Google account accessed from my laptop, a key pair for my Google account accessed from my phone, a key pair for my PayPal account accessed from my desktop, a key pair for my PayPal account accessed from my laptop, and so on and so on. Again, all of this is managed behind the scenes for you. There's nothing you need to keep track of yourself. The service keeps track of all the public keys associated with your account, and each device holds the private keys for the accounts that have been set up on that device. How do you set it up? How passkeys are set up depends on when and where you're doing it. I'll look at two possibilities: creating a new account from scratch and adding passkeys to an existing account on a new device. If you're creating an account from scratch using only passkeys for authentication, the setup process itself, as you're creating the account, will create the key pair used for that service on the machine you're using to create the account. The service will keep a copy of the public key, and the private key will be securely stored only on your machine. You're signed in on that machine automatically as needed. Now, the process should also have you set up additional information so that you can sign into the account without a passkey. Usually, this is something like an email address or a mobile number at which you could receive a confirmation code. This is used to sign you in on additional devices on which you've not yet set up a passkey. So, when you're signing into a new, or as many people ask about, a replacement device, the process is a little different. Whether or not you're already using passkeys with an existing account, you can add a passkey when signing into a new or a replacement device for accounts that support it. Step one is to first sign in some other way. There will be another way. Like I said before, you'd be setting up at least some kind of email address or phone number or some other approach that would authenticate you the first time you sign into that account on a new device. Using a password, for passwordless accounts, you might use the code sent to an email address or a mobile number, or you might confirm a prompt on a different device that you've already signed in. Remember, you could do this without passwords. It's just less convenient. There's a few additional steps, and you're also relying then on your ability to access your email or access your mobile. Once you're signed in, again, using something other than a passkey, since you haven't set one up yet, many services will just now offer to set up the passkey if they notice that there's no passkey for the device on which you're signing in. You can typically also visit the account security settings for that account to set one up. The passkey setup process, again, it creates a key pair for use for that service and stores the private key on your machine. You're signed in from that machine automatically as needed thereafter without needing to go through those additional hoops. Using passkeys. So when you visit a site for which you have set up a passkey, you sign in by unlocking your phone or Windows with your PIN, your face, your fingerprint, or what other mechanisms you've set up. That's it. You're signed into your account. Even if your phone or computer is already unlocked, your attempt to use a passkey should require the unlock process to kick in again to confirm you are who you say you are. This prevents someone from grabbing your unlocked phone, for example, and then using the passkeys on it. But again, that's it. Now, without a passkey, you can still sign in some other way, but the technique is more cumbersome. You would maybe receive an email with a code to enter or a link to click. You might receive a text message with a code to enter or a link to click. You might receive a notification on another device on which you're already signed in to the same account. You might enter a password if your account still has a password. That last one's important because one of the long-term goals of passkeys is to completely phase out passwords. Once you've signed in one of these other ways, then yeah, you have the option of setting up a passkey. So again, you don't have to jump through those more complicated hoops the next time you sign in on that device. Now, passkeys are often confused with two-factor authentication. They are similar, but in reality, they are two separate things. The best way to think about this is that conceptually, passkeys replace passwords. What that means is that if your account has two-factor enabled, then the first time you sign into a new device, you'll sign in some other way, since by definition it's a new device, there's no passkey in place. That some other way may include needing to respond to the two-factor authentication process. Once you're signed in, you can then set up a passkey if you like to securely streamline future sign-ins on that device. The confusion is that the some other way techniques are sometimes similar to the two-factor authentication mechanisms. All right, why passkeys are secure? Passkeys protect you from the most common ways that passwords are compromised. That's why eventually passwords will become a thing of the past. For example, if there's a data breach, well, if you're using passkeys, there's no impact because the public key that, even if it is found in the data breach, is useless anywhere but at the legitimate service. If you're using passwords, well, it's low impact, unless the breached service has really poor security, in which case it's kind of high impact. Phishing. If you're using passkeys, there's no impact. Passkeys cannot be phished. Obviously, if you're using passwords, yeah, it's high impact if you happen to hand over your password to the hacker who has successfully phished you. Malware and keyloggers. Again, if you're using passkeys, there's nothing secure to type or log, so there's no impact. If you're using passwords, very high impact, as merely typing your password could cause it to be captured. If you lose your device, if you're using passkeys, it's low impact. Passkeys are protected by your device's unlock process, and they can be revoked remotely. If you're using passwords, of course, it's moderate impact, depending on exactly how you store your passwords. Reuse. If you're using passkeys, there is no reuse. There is no impact. Passkeys are unique to each device and each account. If you're using passwords, of course, password reuse is very high impact. Using the same passwords for multiple accounts is perhaps right now the most common way that accounts get compromised. Brute force attacks. If you're using passkeys, there's really no impact. While technically, pedantically, a brute force is possible, the amount of time required is so ludicrously long that it's impractical. What's ludicrously long? Centuries? If you're using passwords, well, the impact is moderate. Poor password choices can often easily be brute forced, as can poor storage techniques on part of the online service. All right. Where passkeys are stored. Remember, it's your possession, your ability to use the corresponding private key that allows you to confirm that you are you. That's a sensitive piece of information, not unlike a password. It's stored securely in one of several different ways. In your operating system's secure credential storage. This isn't your browser saving a password. This is the operating system using its own high security repository. Yeah, this is the TPM. It's the default. When you need to use a passkey, it's your operating system that then requests your PIN, your face, your fingerprint, or whatever other technique might be available. In Windows, it's Windows Hello. On your mobile device, it's typically whatever device unlock process you've chosen. That then allows the operating system to fetch the private key from its secure storage. You might store it in your password manager. Many password managers offer to act as your passkey repository. This allows you to set up a passkey for an account once, and then via the password manager, use that same passkey on multiple devices without having to set up a new one in each place. When you attempt to use a passkey, your password vault will then confirm you are authorized with either your master password, a separate PIN, or the operating system provided methods we just talked about. On a hardware security key. Some, though not all, hardware security keys, like this YubiKey, can be used to store a limited number of passkeys. Like using a password vault, this allows you to have a single passkey for an account that you carry with you and use as needed by providing the security key at authentication time. In all cases, the private key is stored securely. While we can never say never, it's extremely unlikely that a passkey's private key would ever be compromised, much more unlikely than security associated with all the other authentication techniques. Bottom line here, of course, is to get ready for passkeys. It's going to take a lot of time. I'm thinking it's going to take years for more and more services to add passkey support, but this does seem to be the direction authentication is headed. I enable it whenever it's offered. The good news is that the transition may be largely transparent. You'll just start using passwords less and less often as passkeys are set up behind the scenes. For updates, for related links, for comments, and more, visit askleo.com/157308. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.